is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. Very excited to bring you an episode that I think you're really going to enjoy. You might have already discovered the title, but if not, the title of this particular episode is Lessons from Steve Jobs Applied to Dentistry. This is episode 499 of the Thriving Dentist Show. That means that next week will be episode 500. We have a very special episode coming up on episode 500. You're not going to want to miss that one. If you haven't subscribed already, I want to encourage you to subscribe so you don't miss episode 500. I have another announcement to make before we get started into the lessons from Steve Jobs applied to dentistry. And that announcement is another top clinical tip. And this one comes from Dr. Sonia Chopra. She's an endodontist from the East Coast, and Dr. Chopra is going to share with you how to improve your endodontic diagnosis. She is the founder of eSchool. It's an online site all about endodontics. I think you're going to enjoy this top clinical tip from Dr. Sonia Chopra.
Hi there, I'm Dr. Sonia Chopra. I'm a board-certified endodontist in Charlotte, North Carolina, and creator and founder of eSchool, Everyday Endo Made Easy, an online endodontic education platform. I am passionate about getting the right diagnosis for my patients and saving teeth, and also helping others be just as passionate about the topic. My hope is to make everyone think about endodontics differently. I know many people shy away from endo, and so they don't really want to pay much attention to it, especially when they refer most of their patients out of the door to a specialist. But every time your patients are having pain and you are making a diagnosis of that pain, you are doing endo, my friends, and you do this every single day in your practice. And even if you are just triaging your patient and nothing else, this piece is critical to the success of your practice. Today, I want to share some of my favorite tips that will help you get the right diagnosis every time. I am a big advocate of the Cole test, and this one test will help you get your patient the treatment that they need. This will help you if you are doing the treatment yourself or even if you are referring them out, because we want to get that patient in the right seat. You don't want somebody who needs an extraction going to the endodontist or someone who needs a root canal going to the oral surgeon or the periodontist. Why is this important? Because you don't want people to have the same symptoms after they have invested their time and money in treatment that didn't solve their problem, or even simply end up at the wrong specialist. This is a surefire way for your patients to lose trust in you and the process. So follow these important clinical steps and you will be on your way to better diagnostic success. Step one is pretty simple. Make sure you are performing a Cole test every time. Anytime you meet a new patient or an emergency patient, always perform a Cole test. Don't just treat the radiograph, because that kind of diagnosis can get you in a lot of trouble. You should be using endo-ice more often than you think. This little but very fierce test will show you if your problem is an endodontic problem or a non-endodontic problem. Let me walk you through a few examples where this test can be really helpful. First, if your patient presents with a radiographic lucency on the x-ray, don't treat the radiograph and assume the tooth is necrotic and needs endo. Do a cold test first, and if the tooth responds to cold, it means the tooth is vital, and you know that that patient does not need to be sent to the endodontist. They need to either go to an oral surgeon or a periodontist, depending on the case. Second, if you do a Cole test prior to preparing a tooth for a crown, you can learn early on if the tooth is necrotic and not after you've cemented the crown. And many times when you get a significant response to a Cole test, you can tell if root canal therapy is more likely a possibility after you prep the crown. And then you can inform your patient ahead of time and set their expectations. So you may be able to help diminish the phrase, "Well, it didn't hurt me until you touched it." These are scenarios that I see often in my practice and where I see patients getting frustrated and losing faith in their dentist. And the last thing, as a specialist, that we want is for you to lose your patient within the referral process. Step 2, when doing the cold test, don't use a cotton swab to do your endo test. That wooden stick inside that swab will not allow the cotton to get cold enough, and you will think that all of the teeth that you test don't feel cold and are therefore necrotic. Instead, use a cotton pellet and a pair of college pliers with your endo ice to do that cold test to make sure that that cotton pellet gets really steamy with that cold spray. Step 3, make sure you prepare your patients for the cold test. I know it's not a fun test to perform, and to many people, it can be really sensitive. So give your patient a little warning. Describe the test and what to expect from the test, and explain what you're looking for, and then do the test so that they can be a little more prepared. It's really important not to be afraid to do the cold test because you don't want to hurt your patients. If you give them a little warning, they will understand what you are trying to do, and they will honestly thank you for it, and you will get the real response from your patient that will get you the right diagnosis in the end. So don't be afraid to do the test. Do it to get the right information and understand that it may make your patient a little uncomfortable for a minute. Step 4, always start your cold test with a tooth in another quadrant. And if you can, find a tooth that is clinically similar to the tooth in question. For example, if tooth number 3 is a suspect tooth and it has a crown on the tooth, find another first molar in any other quadrant with a crown and use that tooth as your control tooth so you can test what is normal for that patient. If you do the cold test on tooth number 14 and they basically levitate in the chair when you place the cold on the tooth, then you know that their teeth are pretty sensitive, but that is their normal response. Once you assess what is normal for that patient, you can start testing in the problem quadrant. Remember, this will be different for every patient that you treat, and you will start to recognize that the beauty of the cold test is really in the interpretation of that test for that patient sitting in front of you. Understanding your diagnosis is the most important step in everything that we do as dentists. And when we have the right diagnosis, it will guide us in how we anesthetize our patients, because vital teeth may need more anesthesia than a necrotic tooth. It will also help us guide us when we treat our patients, because we will need to do different things to a vital tooth versus a necrotic tooth in order to get our patients out of pain and to keep them out of pain. We will also be able to know better how to medicate our patients, because antibiotics will have very little effect on a vital tooth, but could have a pretty big impact on a necrotic tooth. And last but not least, it will also help us follow up on our patients. A vital tooth will sometimes have a totally different postoperative sequela than a necrotic tooth. So I hope you see the importance in this and letting your diagnosis guide you in all of these aspects of treatment. So in summary, make sure you use your cold test anytime you are looking for a pulpal diagnosis or schedule that crown. Use a cotton pellet instead of your cotton swab to do that cold test, and get a baseline by testing a similar tooth in a different quadrant. And finally, don't shy away from the cold test. Let your patient know that they may be a little sensitive, and let your cold test guide you in getting the patient the best outcome and experience. Believe it or not, this little shift in your workflow will help your patients build more trust and loyalty in you and your practice. For more endodontic tips like this one, you can visit soniachopradds.com.
Welcome to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. Hope you enjoyed the clinical tip from Dr. Chopra. Today's topic is lessons from Steve Jobs applied to dentistry. Lessons from Steve Jobs applied to dentistry. Some of you may or may not know, I'm a huge fan of Steve Jobs. I mean, outside of my father, I felt like Steve Jobs had the most influence in my life. I read every book he ever touched, every speech he ever gave. I watched it on YouTube. and of course, read multiple books about him. So he influenced me, even though I've never met the guy. Of course, he has a pretty rough reputation as arrogant and, you know, demanding and so forth. But I felt he did some unbelievable things, you know, in the world we live in. So in my book, he is amazing. He's a genius. So Gary, I'm so glad you picked this topic. Lessons from Steve Jobs applied to dentistry. Let's jump in.
You know, Naren, one of the things that I like to do is look outside of our profession for inspiration. We can often look at what other people are doing, what other industries are doing, what other professions are doing, and then bring it back and adapt it to dentistry. And that's certainly the case with this topic for this podcast episode. And we've got some resources we're going to share with our listeners that I want to strongly encourage you to access these resources. In 2005, Steve Jobs was invited to give the commencement address at Stanford University. And we have a copy of that that we're going to post in the show notes. It's on YouTube, so we were able to distribute that. And it's actually the video of his commencement address in 2005. If you haven't seen that, I'm going to tell you that, now let me disclaim this right from the get. I am an Apple fanboy. There it is, disclosed. I am an Apple fanboy. And while I do understand that there are certainly elements of Steve Jobs' personality that were, let's just say, less savory and controversial, I also have appreciation for his accomplishments. And I happen to believe that this commencement address made to the 2005 graduating class of Stanford University is the best commencement address in history. You're going to want to watch that. It's not long, but it's impactful. You'll remember it for the rest of your life. We're also going to share with you a written transcript of that commencement address, a written transcript. So if you're a reader, you might want to read that. You might want to highlight it. You might want to read it. I actually have a copy of it that I keep in my backpack. I use a backpack rather than a briefcase. And I have a copy of that commencement address, and I reread it about once a month and have done so since 2005. It seems like every time I reread it, I discover something else that I didn't discover before because of the mind space that I'm in at that time. So we've got those resources. Just go to thrivingdentist.com. You know, look at the episode. You'll find it in the episode show notes. If you've never done that, that'll be a good way for you to access the resources that we provide. Now, the commencement address essentially revolves around three topics. Naren, can I list each topic and then talk about how this can apply to dentistry? Does that sound good?
That sounds perfect, Gary. Thank you.
So the first message has to do with a concept that Steve shares where he said, in life, you can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect the dots of your life when you look at it in reverse, in backwards, after events have happened. You can't connect them looking forward because we don't know what's going to happen in the future. But after the fact, you can connect dots and you can look backward and you can start to make sense of it. And he tells a wonderful story. And you know, the story is he was a student at a small liberal arts college in Portland, Oregon. You know, he could have gone to college anywhere, and he chose to go to this this college. And many of you will know that Steve Jobs was adopted, and his parents they were middle.
I think the college was called Occidental College, if I'm not mistaken.
Not sure that was the name of the school. I think it was Reed.
R-E-E-D. Oh, yeah, you're right. Reed College. Yes, yes, yes. Reed. Yes, college. Yes, yes, yes.
But his parents, Steve Jobs' parents, were middle class folks.
Yeah.
Who didn't have means. And he wasn't very interested. Steve Jobs was not interested in college. He had no interest in it.
Especially when he found out it's as expensive as Stanford.
It was as expensive as Stanford. It was a private liberal arts college, but his parents were making the sacrifice for him to go to school.
Right.
So he dropped out. He dropped out of college. By the way, Steve Jobs is not a college graduate.
Yeah.
He dropped out. However, he dropped back in. And he started just going to classes. Once he dropped out of college, he freed him up to go interested in. And he would just drop into these classes. He wouldn't take tests, wouldn't, you know, be part of, you know, when they called roll call or anything, he would just drop in. And he studied stuff he was interested in. And one of the things he was interested in was calligraphy. And he said, I had no idea why I was interested in calligraphy. It was just something that I found beautiful. I'd look at this beautiful scripts and how artistic it was. And I came to really appreciate it. And I attended, you know, many, many, many classes on calligraphy at Reed
College. Reed is one of the best places to study calligraphy, even though he didn't know that something that's going to make a difference in his life.
And so while he had no idea where that exploration was going to lead him, in hindsight, we all know where it led him, because Apple is known for some very artistically designed fonts and styles and artistry and expression. And that's where it came from. And so here's how we connect this to dentistry. You never really know who the influencers in your life are going to be. Afterwards, you can figure it out. In 1982, I was invited to go to the Pankey Institute. My colleagues of mine, they invited me to go. I didn't know what it was. I didn't know who Dr. L.D. Pankey was. But the way they presented it, my mentors presented to me is, Gary, this is an incredible opportunity. You need to go. And so I flew to Florida on my own dime. I was just starting my career. Money was scarce. And that was a sacrifice. And little did I know that I would have the opportunity to meet Dr. L.D. Pankey. When I visited the Pankey Institute, he was 82 years old at the time, and he was making a guest appearance there. He was not a part of their everyday curriculum at 82 years old, but he would come on occasion and just appear. And I had the opportunity to meet him, and I was mesmerized by his message, and his passion around the people side of dentistry. And there was a quote that I learned when he said, "Gary, I want to share something with you." And we were sitting one-on-one, he said, I want to share something with you. And he said, feel welcome to share this with dentists that you meet. And you're welcome to quote me on this if you like. But a quote that I really like is, I've never seen a tooth walk into my office. And I understood what that meant, or I thought I did. You know, I understood much deeper at a later date as I reflected upon it. But what he meant by that, of course, is that, it's kind of a trick question. Are you treating teeth or are you treating people? Well, the truth is you're treating both. On a clinical level, you are treating teeth. But on a much, much more significant level, you're treating a human being. And that was 1982. I was early in my career. That's something that has lived with me and burns as bright. He ignited a passion in my career that burns as brightly today. So how can you apply this to dentistry? Constantly be curious, take courses, meet mentors, reach out to people that you respect. You never know where that's going to lead you. You're never going to know where that's going to lead you. All right. His second point is all about find what you love. Find what you love. So let me read a part of that I have up on my screen. Your work is going to fill, this is from Steve Jobs, and this is from the commencement address. Your work is going to fill a large part of your life. And the only way to be truly satisfied is to do what you believe is great work. And the only way to do great work is to love what you do. If you haven't found it yet, keep looking. Don't settle. Wow. How can that apply to dentistry, Naren? so many ways. The truth is, I believe every dentist at some point in their career had a passion for this profession. At some point, this is what they wanted to do. I mean, you don't accidentally become a dentist.
Right.
There is nothing accidental about it. It's intention and it's pursuit. Think about the day you got your acceptance letter to dental school. Just how much joy you felt. Maybe up until that point in your life, that was the happiest day in your life. Now, maybe that's been replaced now by your marriage date or the day you had children. But up until that point, that might have been the happiest day in your life because you were going to get to follow your dream and become a dentist. But it seems like over time, life has a way of sort of beating you up.
Yeah.
what you thought it was going to be didn't turn out. But what is Steve's message? The only way to do great work is to love what you do.
And one thing that he did is he, when he didn't like something, he changed it. Like, I mean, when he came into the phone business, or Apple came into the phone business, there were these careers that controlled everything, right? I mean, they decided what apps went in and the rules and everything. He said, nope, if you're going to sell my iPhone, I'm going to control what's on the phone. I'm going to control the app store. So he changed the rule. I mean, in dentistry, like I know, like you, Gary, and what you teach your practice owners, you know, they don't have to accept 44% off every single case for the rest of their lives. You know, like in your case, you and Dr. Paul created something where, you know, you still are very kind and take care of all the insurance patients, but you're not a PPO driven, dictated by PPO practice. You create the life you want.
So to apply this to, you're absolutely right, Aaron, and to apply this to dentistry is, doctors, if you're at a point where if you ask the question, do you truly love what you do? And the answer is, you know, not quite. Then what I would encourage you to do is answer this question. If your practice was as good as it could be, what would that look like? And I'll bet if you took the time to think about it, you could answer that question and then proceed to make the changes to make it that way. You know, we live in an amazing country here in the United States where we have freedom of choice. You have the freedom to design your practice any way you like. Now, it may take a process to get there. It may not happen overnight. But, you know, your work, as Steve said, your work is going to fill a large part of your life. And the only way to be satisfied is to truly love what you do. What would make it that you love going to work? What would be TGIM for you? And then define it. You can't get there if you don't know where there is. And then start to work backwards from there and take the steps forward to move you closer to that objective.
I love your definition of thriving practice. What is the definition, Gary?
Well, my definition of a thriving practice is one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. I want all three. Personal satisfaction, meaning you're providing the interaction with people that you truly love. You're making a difference in the lives of your patients. Put another way, you're making a difference in the lives of your patients. Professional satisfaction means you're doing the kind of dentistry that you love to do. Hey, if you love placing and restoring implants, design your practice so you place and restore more implants. If you love doing adult orthodontics, design your practice so you can do more of that. But you've got freedom of choice. Follow it. The third lesson from that famous commencement address was rather cryptic. At that point, Steve had been diagnosed with terminal cancer. And it was a point that he was making about death. And the specific point was, and again, this is a quote from Steve from that commencement address. Your time on earth here is limited. So don't waste it living someone else's life. Now, there was more to that. That's why I want you to actually watch it and read it and really absorb yourself in that commencement address. But the point that I want to make on the podcast is just that. Your time on earth is limited. You know, the older I get, the more realistic that it strikes me as, Aaron. Yes. You know, it's limited.
I agree. I feel like I need to run as fast as I can because my time is, you know, there's a clock somewhere ticking.
There's a clock somewhere. And, you know, yes, we can do some. Our great friend, Dr. Uchi Odiatu, shares wonderful health tips to help us live long, healthy lives. And he talks about health span. And what health span is not just long life, but long, healthy lives. And so I plan to be around for a long time. But let's face it, ultimately, it's limited. Don't waste your life living someone else's life. And what does that mean? How can I apply that to dentistry? I think some dentists believe that, you know, there's just, you know, one tried and true way to be a dentist because it's what everyone else is doing. And in fact, there's plenty of opportunity for you to do dentistry your own way. Your own way. There's plenty of opportunity. So if you haven't answered the question, What would your practice look like if it was as good as it could possibly be? You owe yourself the luxury of thinking about that. Because you can't get there if you don't know where there is. And you know, I want to add another term. I think it's very accurate to say that Steve Jobs left a legacy here on Earth. Would you agree with that, Nair?
Oh, 100%. I mean, I remember the day he died or the week he died. I mean, all over the globe, you know, in rich countries, poor countries, English-speaking countries, languages you don't understand, Japan, you name it. People, millions of people pay tribute. I mean, it's crazy. And he is an industrialist, a billionaire, you know, a person who didn't do one bit of charity, didn't do any of that, but he left a legacy for sure.
Yeah. And so I have a question for you, Doctor. Are you creating a legacy? You know, I asked that question. I've asked that question over 10,000 times to dentists in my life. Are you creating a legacy? The answer I hear most commonly, Naren, is it goes like this, Naren, some variation of this. Gary, I really do enjoy being a dentist. And I really believe that myself and my team provide quality dentistry. I'm very proud of what we do. And I'm proud of the work that we do. And I'm proud of how we take care of our patients. But to be quite honest with you, in terms of it, does it meet the definition of a legacy? I don't think I'm quite there. So I'm hearing some variation of I'm proud of what I'm doing, but not quite at the legacy level. So if you would answer it something like that, I'd have two more questions for you. My next question is, what would need to change for you to begin to create a legacy? What would need to change? And again, I'm going to contend that very few people ever put that intention out there and answer that question, but I want you to do it. I want you to go to the place in the world where you do your best thinking. Maybe that's at the beach. Maybe it's in the mountains. Maybe it's alongside a river. Maybe it's sitting on your back porch. Maybe it's in your recliner in your library. Go to the place where you do your best thinking and answer that question. What would need to change for you to begin to create a legacy? And I believe that everyone listening to this podcast could answer that question if they just allowed themselves the luxury of thinking about it. And then my next question is, when will you begin to make those changes? You know, there's a quote in the world of ecology that I like a lot. It applies. The best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The next best time to plant a tree is today.
Right now.
Right now. Right now. So there's those three topics, those three talking points from Steve Jobs' 2005 commencement address at Stanford University. Number one, connecting the dots. Lesson about connecting the dots. Number two, find what you love. Find what you love. And number three, your time is limited. Don't waste it living someone else's life. Naren, we've got some great questions from our listeners coming up. Let's hit pause here on the Coaching in Action segment and go on to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. I love today's Coaching in Action, Gary. The topic was lessons from Steve Jobs applied to dentistry. I mean, Steve Jobs is a genius and what you shared is awesome. Thank you so much for that, Gary. Let me jump into the questions. The first question, I'm an associate where I was promised the opportunity for equity. It has been just over 3 years and I'm no closer to equity than when I started. Any advice?
Yeah, wow, what a very candid question. And I suspect that there are many of our listeners that might apply to or in the future might bump into a situation. One of the things I teach my dental students, most of you know that I teach on Mondays at Midwestern University School of Dental Medicine in Glendale, Arizona. It's one of my ways to give back to our amazing profession. And I teach practice management and the people side of dentistry, the humanistic side of dentistry. But one of the things I teach my dental students is that if they find themselves in a career path that isn't getting them where they need to go, it's perfectly okay to pivot. You know, pivot. You're not a tree. Move.
I like that.
You know, I mean, if you're a tree, you're kind of stuck.
Right.
You can't move. But you're not a tree. Move. Pivot. And so if you find yourself, you know, I'm struck, I'll leave the name out of it, but recently I received an email from a young dentist from Texas. And he said, You know, Gary, I'm a listener to your podcast, and thank you for providing this resource for us. And I was compelled to reach out to you. May I tell you my story? He said, I joined this practice about 5 years ago, and there was overtures of opportunity for equity becoming a partner in this practice. It's a multi-doctor practice, and there were some promises made about the opportunity to have equity and to become a partner in this practice. And he said, it's 5 years later, and I'm no closer to that now. What should I do? So very much like the question that came up, you know, in our listener here. And so what I would say, first of all, is let's not make any assumptions. First, go to the owner and have a crucial conversation with the owner, because it may be that there's some assumption. Maybe they're thinking, well, maybe you don't want equity. You haven't brought it up, you know, or who knows. So first of all, have that conversation with the owner. And be prepared for that. Read the book, Crucial Conversations, before you have that conversation, because you'll be more effective at it. We're doing that book as part of our book club for my coaching clients. And I've read it many times, but I've reread it now in preparation for book club. And I'm reminded of just how valuable the information in the book, Crucial Conversations, is. Would you agree, Naren?
I agree, Gary. I think one of the things that your clients love the most is the book club. And the reason is, even if they don't have 10 hours to read a book, you and your team do an amazing job in kind of giving them the essence, the key points. And this book, in my mind, is a classic. You know, I think 7 Habits of Highly Effective People is a classic. Crucial Conversations is a classic. And by the way, the foreword was written by Stephen Covey, who wrote the 7 Habits. So I'm pretty sure he knows a thing or two about good books.
Yeah. And talk about a man with integrity. He would write anything that he didn't believe heart and soul about.
Yes.
Yeah, that's for sure. So, doctor, read the book Crucial, or listen to the book Crucial Conversation. If you're a reader, read it. If you're a listener, listen to it. And then sit down with the owner or owners and have a candid conversation. And maybe that'll lead you to that equity path. Maybe you want to stay there. Maybe that's where you see your career blossoming. And perhaps you discover that that isn't where you want to be. Then pivot. If you're a bright young dentist investing heart and soul in a practice, I can assure you that somewhere there will be an equity spot for you. And maybe you'll be compelled to purchase your own practice and be the captain of your own ship. But the message I want to have to you is it's perfectly okay to pivot. So you know, I actually reached out to that doctor that I told you about, sent me the email. We scheduled a call, and he said, Gary, but I feel like I've invested 5 years of my life here. Now, can you understand that, Naren? I mean,
yes,
I get it. It's like, I don't want to give up in these 5 years, but it's like, if it isn't going to get you where you want to go, pivot.
Yeah.
Because, you know, what if you stay there another 20, then it's going to be 20 years of dissatisfaction. So don't use the excuse of I've invested 5 years of my life here, to stay. You have choice.
Because you don't have any control over the past. The only control you have is this second forward. So don't waste this second forward just because something happened five years.
Right. But I understand, you know, the emotional investment you might have. Say, I don't want to just give up on this. But if it isn't getting you where you want to go, give yourself permission to pivot. And there will be an opportunity, you know, in a partnership, perhaps, in owning your own practice and bringing perhaps somewhere down the road, you bring someone in and you get to captain your own ship. Pivot, though, would be my answer, my quick answer to that question.
Absolutely, Gary. Let me go to the next question. Steve Jobs, his concept of finding what you love really resonates with me. I would love to have a cosmetic exclusive dental practice. Does that make sense?
Well, have you ever heard the saying, Naren, if it's been done before, it must be possible?
Absolutely. Yes. I think I heard it from you.
I have said that a time or two. If it's been done before, it must be. So, doctor, yes, there are plenty of great examples of a cosmetic exclusive practice. Remember, of course, cosmetic dentistry is not a specialty. It would be a general dental practice that provides cosmetic dentistry. However, I want you to think about something. And I don't want to put a cloud, you know, on your horizon on this one. But I wonder if a better model might be to have a general dental practice that does a whole lot of cosmetic dentistry, I think that might be a better model. You know, a general dental practice that does a lot of cosmetic dentistry. Let me tell you why I believe that. Very often, so if you have a cosmetic practice, it's going to be a very narrowly defined practice. There'll be a lot of people, the public, that won't think that's the right practice for them, you know, because maybe they're not interested in cosmetic dentistry. If you have a general dental practice where we bring different types of patients in our practice, very often we can plant seeds with them and we can percolate those seeds to create interest in helping that patient have the smile of their dreams. And we can do a whole lot of cosmetic dentistry by planting seeds and having a slightly broader practice model. Just something to think about. But yes, you absolutely can have a cosmetic exclusive practice. And if that is what you are driven to do, then I'm going to be your biggest cheerleader to do that. But do consider what I've said about the idea of a slightly broader practice. It doesn't mean you have to do everything. You know, one of the things I love about, you know, my clients can choose the services they want to provide in their practice. David Hornberg is a long time friend of mine. And I'm going to use David as an example here. By the way, David practice in San Diego is a general practice with very much a cosmetic focus, but it's not cosmetic exclusive. He does probably more cosmetic dentistry than just about anyone on the planet, but he has a little bit broader draw, just like I described earlier. But David doesn't like doing endo. I want to describe what David, and no offense to Dr. Sonia Chopra, because many dentists like doing endo. Right. But the way David described endo to me, he said, "Gary, here's how I look at it." Remember, he's an artist. He loves cosmetic dentistry. He said, "Endo feels like picking locks in the dark." So you don't have to do endo. Now, if you like doing endo, follow Dr. Sonia Chopra's advice. Be part of her e-school community and do a bunch of endo. But pick the things you like to do and do more of those. Great question, though. I'm glad you asked that question.
Yeah, and I have to kind of second your thought process about having a general practice that also does cosmetic, because, you know, as a marketing person, sometimes doctors come to me for advice. And I think it depends also on your goals. Like, for example, if you want a sellable practice, it's going to be easier to sell a general practice because somebody else can take it and run with it, because people need cleanings, they need fillings. It's something that can be systematized and scaled. Cosmetic also can be scaled, but typically people are coming for that particular doctor. So, you know, let's say if you're retiring, the value of the practice, if it's a pure cosmetic practice, won't be that high because it's all the goodwill is tied to you. So I think it comes down to kind of, you know, I think Gary's right, you know, what your goals are and, you know, where you're trying to get to.
Sure. You bet. Great question. I love that question.
Let me ask the third question, Gary. I love this question. Clearly, Steve Jobs created a legacy. I second that, Gary. How can I do that in my dental practice?
Well, thank you for that question, because you know, we talked about it a little bit in the coaching in action segment, but I hope every one of our listeners is on a path to create a legacy. Now, what does that mean? What does a legacy mean? To me, it means that your impact goes on long after you've left. And clearly, Steve Jobs has met that definition. His impact is still being felt today in so many circles, in many, 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 many ways. So it's really about creating a practice that lives beyond your time as the owner of that practice. It's a legacy in your community. It's a legacy with your patient base. It's a legacy of empathy. It's a legacy of compassion. It's a legacy of passion, being passionate about helping your patients have the best possible oral health. And so how can you apply that? I think you need to answer those questions that I provided in the coaching in action segment. Is that what would need to change for you to begin to create a legacy? And maybe just hypothetically, it's your relationship with the dental insurance companies. Maybe that's what needs to change. There was a pregnant pause there for effect, Aaron.
Yes.
maybe that's the part that sucks all the joy out of your practice. Maybe that's the part that has so many consequences that you don't like. Like, you don't have enough time to spend with patients. I can't use the quality of lab that I want to use. I can't pay my team members what they're worth. And maybe that one decision starts the domino falling, the dominoes falling. And all of a sudden, things start to come into focus. But what would need to change? And then just systematically start to make those changes. And I'll take a selfish promotion for just a minute. If you'd like help with that, I'd love to be your coach.
Absolutely. And by the way, Gary, one of the things I think this question about legacy is, I think he realized it, and you mentioned it in your coaching in action, that we all realize it the older we get, right? And he realized it with his cancer scare, you know, but when he was giving that speech at Stanford, he has gone through some cancer treatment. At that very moment, he thought he's going to live. So he was very optimistic, but still he realized his days are, you know, limited on this earth. And I mean, in that context, you want, on the day you're going to die, you want to look back and say, you know what, I think I did a good job with my life. I was given this life, and, I did my best, and no regrets. Right. So,
and you, all of our listeners deserve that. They deserve to create a legacy. So figure out what are the impediments? What are the hurdles? What are the roadblocks?
Get rid of it.
Get rid of them. And then systematically, step by step, get rid of those. So there's my advice for creating, answer the question, what would need to change for you to begin to create a legacy?
Get it, do you mind?
If you allow yourself the luxury of time to think about that, you'll be able to answer that in a specific reference to you right now today.
Do you mind, Gary, if we include a link to a coaching strategy meeting with you in case somebody is really serious about this and they want to have a conversation with you?
Oh, absolutely. I would love that. That's a Zoom meeting. We'll meet virtually. My goal in that meeting is to learn more about your practice, learn more about you and what your goals are, and then share with you what our coaching looks like and see if that might be a good fit. I'd love to, and I do that myself. I don't don't delegate that to someone else. I do that myself. I'd love the opportunity to meet with any of our listeners online if that was appropriate. You bet. We'll put a link in there. Just click the link. It's an online schedule. You just pick the time and day that works for you. And I'd love to meet you.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask the last question. It seems like dentistry doesn't have much room for creativity. Frankly, it's a bit of a conformist profession. How can I exercise my creativity within this profession?
What a true observation and a great question. Dentistry is a bit conformist, isn't it? Because it's based on science, right?
Yes.
However, yes. I would actually disagree in some ways that while science is science, there's still plenty of room for creativity in your practice.
I mean, to start off with your dream, right? Your legacy, thinking about your legacy and what you want your legacy to be. You can be very creative with your legacy.
Be creative with your vision. Be creative with your legacy. Be creative with the humanistic side of your practice. There's plenty of room for creative. You know, what I mean by the humanistic side, the behavioral side, is where we truly have a relationship-driven practice. We know our patients' names. We know their spouses' names. We know their kids' names. We know the dog's name. We know their hobbies. We know their interests. We know the important dates in life. We know where they went to school. We know their values. And if you really double down on that, that's your secret sauce. That's your secret sauce. People want to connect with people more today than ever, especially in the world that we live in that is going more and more technical and more digital. The more digital the world goes, the more we long for connection. Connection. You know, think about it. It wasn't that long ago where we could connect with people in a lot of different ways. You know, we would go shopping. We'd go to the store and connect with people. Today, much of that, you know, is replaced and can be replaced, you know, with digital interaction. Online, you can do all your shopping online these days. And so while the world's going more digital, and I'm a nerd and I have a high appreciation for that, in a way, counterbalancing that on the other hand is we have a deeper need for connection.
Yeah, I think the Harvard study talked about the happiest people and they all had great relationships. I mean, they followed these people for 50 years. So I think you're absolutely right. There's a huge opportunity to, you know, be friends with lots of people and grow, you know, like see them through. Like, I mean, I know many of your clients have kids and grandkids, and you know, like it's just they're part of the life of that particular family.
So maybe creativity is not defined necessarily in the clinical realm. It's defined in every other aspect of the profession. There's many other. What about
another example I can think of? You told me recently is one of your clients' team members. You know, by the time she was retiring, she had a pretty big savings. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, you know, this is a long time client of mine. We started working together in 1990, and one of the things we did early on was we created a pension plan for the practice, so the doctor could create a retirement plan for himself and also for his team members. And recently, his longtime office manager, it was time for her to retire. And she was able to retire with more than seven digits in the pension plan as a result from her work in this practice for these many years. And think of that difference that made in her life. A massive difference. And so we can get creative about how we interact with our team. We can get creative about how we participate in charity. Doctor, you know, so many dentists find creative ways to give back. Maybe you create a charity in your own town to help people in your community that are disadvantaged and don't have access to dental care. So many different ways you can exercise your creativity that might fall outside of necessarily the clinical realm, but there's many other ways to do this. So I want to encourage you to be creative and really kind of think along the lines of Steve Jobs. Don't try to, make a better mousetrap. Come up with something completely out of color outside of the lines. This client of mine who his office manager retired with a seven-digit pension plan in her. You know, her value of the pension plan is more than seven digits. One of the things he believed in was getting involved in charitable work, not only in dentistry, but broader than just dentistry. And he used to fund, and he still does this, a trip, a one-week trip a year with Habitat for Humanity. And doctor and the team go somewhere in the United States, and they build houses. You're probably familiar, Naren, with the...
Yes.
I think their poster child for Habitat for Humanity is President Carter.
Yes.
Carter. And anyway, they build houses and he funds that. What do I mean by he funds that? They get paid that week. They get paid their income. So they're not losing their income. He funds the travel expenses. He funds the hotel expenses, the meal expenses for them to do that. And is there any coincidence that this doctor has zero turnover in his practice, because of how he's created a legacy of taking care of his team members and allowing them, I've met many of his team members where this was the first time they had an opportunity to participate in charity, not because they didn't want to, but because they didn't have the resources to do it before. Now they are providing those resources themselves to be able to do that. So there's lots of creative ways that this can be done. Well, Naren, we had some great questions today. I hope you guys enjoyed this episode as much as I did. Certainly, I want you to circle back, go back and watch the 2005 commencement address to Stanford by Steve Jobs. Read the transcript. Maybe you print it out. Do like I do. Keep it in your backpack and read it every so often just to remind you. On that note, I'm going to tie this back to Steve Jobs. iTunes was created by Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs revolutionized the music industry.
Yes.
So to stay in theme with our episode today, I have a request. If you liked what you heard today, go to iTunes, type in Thriving Dentist Show, and write us a review. That would be a proper tribute to Steve Jobs, and Naren and I would appreciate that.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you in advance. On that note, thank you for the privilege of your time. Hope you've learned some things today. And we look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show, which will be episode number 500. Stay tuned.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.